So I've been thinking a lot about the book of Proverbs, as you might guess, since I'm standing up here talking about it. And I was thinking this week, in some ways, as I mentioned, Proverbs is very easy, right? It's not deep and hard to understand. It's just deep and hard to apply and to do. But on the other hand, we pretty much think that we do it anyway. If we're reading through, oh yeah, that doesn't apply to me. You know, yeah, that doesn't apply to me. And I was wondering about that. I think it's because our culture is based on a Christian heritage, right? Judeo-Christian values from the very beginning of our country. Most of us were raised in the church as well. And so these truths that we're talking about week by week by week seem very natural to us because we grew up in it. It's like breathing the air. How often do you think about the air you breathe? Maybe this morning on a beautiful, crisp fall day, walked outside. Wow, that's great. But generally, we don't think about our air, and generally we don't think about the principles that our Creator made to help us walk through life in joy and happiness. And so today, we're going to be talking about people. We're going to be talking about the people in our neighborhoods because God has given us principles to help us relate to one another well. And again, as I go through these things, I feel almost like I need to apologize for not bringing something deeper and wiser. But the truth is, even though these things are not going to be surprising, to be very honest with you, they are still things that we ought to take to heart and we ought to think about as we go through our day-to-day lives dealing with people around us. So these are the principles of how to deal with people. And what I thought I would do is I would talk about the center of the circle, and then work out further and include more people as we go in our circle. So the first people in our neighborhood, the closest to us would be our spouse, right? Most of us are married, we have spouses, and what does these principles of our Creator say about dealing with your spouse? Well, most of it, again, is pretty straightforward and not surprising, right? Like, be faithful to your spouse, right? I mean, don't have sex with other people. That's pretty standard. Anybody surprised by that? Yeah, I didn't think so. But you know, this faithfulness and this loyalty that we're talking about isn't just talking about sex. It's also talking about your words, right? When you are talking about your spouse to someone, how do you speak about them? Do you build them up? Do you tear them down? Do you complain about them? Do you make fun of them? How do you treat your spouse when your spouse isn't around with other people? That's a little less comfortable concept, isn't it? Because we all have a tendency, not me, nowhere is, we all have a tendency to sometimes say things that we shouldn't say. Next week we're going to talk more about our tongue and guarding the tongue, but for this week we just need to understand that it's our responsibility to build up our spouse and to be faithful to our spouse in every situation we find ourselves. That's easy. And then Proverbs also has many passages talking to the wife or to the husband. So we need to take those into account as well. And I just thought I would start with the wife because there's a lot more up to the wife, you know, a lot more targeted at the wife. Proverbs. I don't know why that is. You all, Proverbs 31, if you're reading through Proverbs day by day by day, I don't know if you read Proverbs 31 or not last month, but that's the godly wife, right? The Proverbs 31 woman, and it's talking about the wife and the mother of her household and how the things that she ought to do, and I'm not going to go through piece by piece by piece, but again, it has to do with building up your family, not tearing the family down, being the person the hub around the family, hardworking, good character, bringing praise to the family, all these sorts of things call the wife to be. And again, being the helpmate to her husband. Wives in the book of Proverbs, I think, have it a lot harder because husbands only have one command. Did you know that? The whole book of Proverbs, there's only one command in the book to husbands specifically. Now, it's given over and over and over, right? It's not just one verse, just kind of a throwaway verse. What husbands are called to do is mentioned five different times in five different verses throughout the book of Proverbs. And you know what it says? Can you guess? It actually, it's the first one of the verses is that first verse from the Proverbs 31 woman. It's chapter 31, verse 10. And it says, "A good wife who can find? She is far more precious," she is far more precious than jewels. Right? One thing, husbands, Proverbs is saying to you, value your wife. In some places it says she's a blessing. In some places it says she's a gift from God. In this verse it says she's precious jewels. Our job as husbands is to value our wives as they deserve to be valued. And of course then, how do you value something? What do you think of something other than your wife that you value? How do you treat that thing? You value your car, are you out there washing it all the time? You value your golf game, are you out there practicing all the time? Do you value watching football? Do you do that all the time? What do you value in your life? Well, your wife is more valuable than that. And you, husbands, have to decide how that value plays out and to make sure she knows that you value her in the way that she deserves to be valued. Husbands, that's your one rule. Value your wife the way she deserves to be valued. Now there's another verse, and it talks about women, and Laura hates this verse, hates it. She knows what I'm going to. It's because when we were young and we first married, and we decided to do this very thing I'm asking you to do, where we read through a chapter of Proverbs a day, and there's one verse that repeats itself over and over and over, like four times in a row, and Laura would read it, and she'd tear her hair out. I don't know, why is God pointing this out to me? It says, "It is better to live on the corner of a roof than in a home with a contentious woman." Yeah, she hated that verse. But, you know, it doesn't have to be just about women, right? I mean, you could turn around. It's better to live on a corner of a roof than in a home with a contentious man, right? We have to try not to fight with one another. We have to not pick fights and look for fights. We're in the conflict class on Wednesday night. We've been talking about how that works and how these fights, and we've all been in these kind of fights before where they start over nothing and then they blow up and they become crazy talk. Crazy cycle is what one author calls it. At the end of the fight, you don't even know what you're fighting about anymore. You're just fighting for the fun of it. Not fun. But you know what I'm saying, right? And so we, as Christian people, need to do a good job of making sure that we are not contentious people, that our homes are calm. And verse 1 of our chapter that Mike read, it says, "Better is a dry morsel with quiet than a house full of feasting with strife." It is our job as husband and wife to make sure that we live in a peaceful home, not filled with contention and with strife. So your spouse is the first place that we see multiple discussion about how to deal with the people in our neighborhood. The second group would be our children and grandchildren. Now here in verse 6 it says, "Grandchildren are the crown of the aged, and the glory of sons is their fathers." Now this is hinting at something, and it only really hints at it in this one verse, but it's a biblical principle that we see throughout the Bible, and that is, it's something that we don't talk about very much. It's called the generational curse. Are you familiar with that? I don't believe I've ever spoken about it before, but starting in Deuteronomy and three or four other places, it says that the sins of the father are visited down to the third and the fourth generation. The sins of the parents show up in the lives of their great-grandchildren. Now, that's a scary thought to me, right? And it doesn't mean that God punishes them for, remember, sins isn't always doing an evil thing. It means missing the mark of God. So what that principle is saying is that I and my behavior and the way I raise my children shows up in my great-grandchildren's lives. We don't like that, right? That's a huge responsibility on Laura and I and on you and those of you who have children and grandchildren and maybe great-grandchildren at this point. But I was just talking with someone just this past week about how that generational curse is seen in their family. We were talking about how her husband's parents had some real problems, and then her husband and she had some real problems, and then their children have some real problems, and these are all seen as a coming down from a place above. And I know we don't like that. I don't like that. But the sins of the fathers are visited to the third and the fourth generation. Now, I like to think that we can turn that around as well. And that the blessings of the father, and that, by the way, is what this verse does, right? It turns that around. I'll read it again. Grandchildren are the crown of the aged, and the glory of sons is in their fathers. And in good way, we as parents and grandparents can impact that third and fourth generation as we are faithful to our God and King. It is so important that we raise our children correctly, because our children will raise their children, who will raise their children. And it becomes a generational curse if we do it wrong. Fortunately, we have God helping us. We have the book of God's Word to give us the principles we need to do it correctly, but we have to do it correctly. So, in Proverbs, we see how to do it correctly. And again, I'm just pulling out. I don't have time to go through every verse that mentions this in the book of Proverbs, but there's three basic things that we as parents, and to a lesser extent, grandparents, can do to help to break a generational curse or to begin a pattern of generational blessing. The first thing that we need to do is we need to lead by example, right? It doesn't matter what you say to your children. It doesn't matter if your children see you not behaving like God is calling you to act. If you are here in church every day or every Sunday morning and you look all prim and proper, and then you go home and you're cursing and watching pornography and gossiping and cutting each other down and fighting all the time, guess what? The hour you spend in church doesn't matter at all compared to the example that we set our children. And you know, the gospel is caught, not taught, is a famous saying, right? And it's the same with our children. They catch more than we teach them by the example we set in our home. I have to say, I am so happy. You guys know that Calvin and Marty and Drew and Calvin are staying with this month. And I have been so blessed that every meal, I mean, he's not even 2 years old. Every meal he folds his hands and says, pray. Now, he doesn't know God, right? He doesn't know what he's taught. But I see in them the fact that they are setting the example of thanking God before meals. It's a little thing, but it's an example that will go for generations. That's incredible to me. So the first thing we do is set example. The second thing we do is we need to give them instruction, right? It doesn't matter what we are doing if we don't teach them. And we say that, you know, well, some people, not us. Some people would say, well, it's the church's job to teach them spirituality. Or they'll decide when they're old enough about their own spirituality. Wrong. Totally unbiblical. We need to teach our children with words who Jesus is and what he's doing, what he's saying, what he's calling from us. And that's why I wanted to bless Noah this morning, because I hear that Noah is doing well and growing up into a godly young man. So Katie, good job. Tell Andrew I said good job as he grows, because obviously he's getting the instruction that he needs to become the godly man that is calling him to be. It takes words. It's not just example. It's words as well. And then finally, there's the discipline, right? We need to have discipline. Spare the rod and spoil the child. Now, that doesn't mean you have to beat the kids, right? Some of my kids got spanked. Some of my kids didn't get spanked. It was what they needed for the discipline. The spare the rod has to do with a shepherd's rod. The shepherd didn't beat the sheep with the rod. He moved them around. He directed them, right? He didn't let the sheep go where they wanted. And that's what that's referring to, is you have to direct your kids, and sometimes they need to be disciplined to keep them going on the right path and going in the right direction. So we need, as parents and, when possible, as grandparents, Laura and I were with our grandchildren yesterday, right? And I love my grandchildren, they're great, but you know, they're kids, right? And so they want to push the boundary. Where's Nana and Papa going to let us go with this one? And so we had to direct them. Didn't hit them, direct them, to make sure they weren't jumping on the couch. We don't mind them jumping on the couch, but their parents don't like it so much. So we kept them from jumping on the couch, you know. Anyway, so with our spouse, we need to be faithful, and we need to be loving, and we need to make sure our wives in particular know their value. With our children, our grandchildren, we need to be examples to them, and we have to remember that goes on and on and on, generation after generation. We talked about friends, and we mentioned that last week a little bit, how in the third ring of our circle, the people in our neighborhood are our friends. And we said we have to choose our friends carefully. That, again, comes up in Proverbs over and over. We choose who we're going to hang around with. We choose who we're going to share our lives with beyond our family. And we should choose wisely on our friends, because our friends will direct us on the path to good, towards God, or away, depending on who they are. So let me ask you, just write out, how did you choose your friends? Who are your friends? Did you think about it, or just happen to be the person who lived next door to you, or is it someone you work with? Where do your friends come from? And did you choose them, or did they just happen? We need to be conscious of who our friends are, and sometimes we need to say, I need to distance myself from you. Sometimes we say, hey, I'd like to grow closer to you, right? We can make that kind of choice of who we're friends with, and how we do that is incredibly important. And then we need to be friends, right? Again, it talks about friendships. So one of the things it says is a friend loves at all times. It's verse 17, a friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. If we're going to be a friend to people, then we need to be their friend when times are hard for them. We can't just drop it. We can't just say, oh, well, you know, I'll see you when you're done with your cancer treatments, right? What does it take to be a friend in every situation? It's our job as a friend to be the friend that we want them to be to us as well. We need to look to see how best to love our friend. Well, another way that we do that is by forgiveness, right? You guys have friends that sometimes step on your toes? Just me? Yeah, sometimes we don't get along. Sometimes our friends offend us. Sometimes they say something hurtful, or they do something that we don't like. But we have to learn to forgive them. Verse 9 says, he who forgives an offense seeks love, but he who repeats a matter alienates a friend. Again, with your words. How do you treat your friends when they do something against you, when they hurt your feelings? Or do you share that? Do you gossip about them? Or do you forgive them, and hopefully maybe even try to restore them to the place they ought to be? That's another point, is that we as friends, it talks about iron sharpens iron. Sometimes we as Christians with our friends, we need to say the hard thing. And sometimes we have to allow those friends to say the hard thing to us, to hear, I'm not walking, I need to hear sometimes, Jim, I don't think the way you're walking with God is sufficient right now. I don't think Laura feels valued in that when you said that right there. So you need to go apologize to her. Or whatever it is, right? We need people in our lives to whom we are willing to be open enough to hear the hard truth and take it to heart and act on it. Because we know that our friends love us and care for us. It says, faithful are the wounds of a friend. And when we have developed a godly friendship, we have to remember that even when they wound us, those wounds are faithful for our good and for the glory of God. So there's our spouse, children and grandchildren, there's our friends, and then finally there is our neighbors, right? The neighbors around us. And I'm talking about physically around us. I'm not talking about neighbors in name only. I'm talking about the people who live next door or down the block or something like that. And there's a lot of verses in Proverbs that also talk about how we should relate to our neighbors. And again, this isn't a huge secret, right? We know what we ought to do for our neighbors. And I question myself, and I question you, whether or not we often act towards our neighbors the way that God is calling us to act towards our neighbors. For instance, we need to respect their time. Proverbs talks about if you say that you're going to do something, then do it. Proverbs talks about respecting their habits. There's a verse in chapter 27 that says that a friend who greets you early in the morning, it will be seen as a curse, right? So basically, if you know your friend is sleeping until 10 o'clock, nothing wrong with that. But if your next door neighbor sleeps till 10 o'clock, don't mow your lawn until after 10 o'clock, right? Let's be the friend, let's be the neighbor that we hope them to be with us. Let's be... to say more than that. You know what your neighbors need. You know who your neighbors are. Even if they're not your friends, you are God's representative to them. How can you do that? How can you love your neighbors in a way that is seemingly normal? whether you know this. The question is, are you doing it? Right? It's easy to know what Proverbs says. We, like I said, we grew up in this culture. We know what's right. We know what's good. We know what's expected. The question is, do we do it? And so that's what I'm asking each of you today. As Lee plays in a moment, I want you to just ask God, am I following these principles that you have created in the world? Am I doing what I need to do with my spouse, with my children, my grandchildren, with my friends, and with my neighbors to be the Jesus follower that I am called to be?